Good evening, guys. Welcome to another episode of DUFC TV. So episode 8 today. As always, thank you so much for everybody who has watched the previous episodes. Again, positive feedback from last week, so really appreciate that. Joined again today, a few familiar faces, and again, a special guest in Mr. Non-League himself, Ollie Bayliss. So if you want to introduce yourself, please, lads.
Yo, George Martin, back again, resident guest here every week.
Ams, the return of the maestro, another week, another episode. Make sure you follow, subscribe. You're missing out if you're not.
Morley's, aka Nana, back again. You know I'm always here anyway, guys. Subscribe.
How's it going, guys? I'm Ollie Bayliss. Thank you for inviting me onto your podcast.
Absolute pleasure, mate. Right, we'll start off. Anybody in non-league or grassroots who doesn't know who Ollie is, I'd be extremely surprised. I will go out as far as to say I don't think I've ever seen football Twitter so unanimously behind one person in terms of information, genuinely, in terms of information and that. If Ollie doesn't say it, it's not true. I feel like that became a thing during lockdown. It was, forget the government advice, forget what other links were being sent. If Ollie didn't tweet it, don't listen to it. How did that feel? Did you get that sort of vibe? Because that's how it came across to myself and a lot of other clubs.
I don't know, that's a bit extreme, but that's a lot of power, isn't it? I mean, I could just...
I mean,
we're all bored. Should I just say now we can play football now? And we'll just...
You might as well.
Why not?
I just do that. I mean, that's very flattering. That there's a lot of people that do some good covering non-league. I think it's growing, actually. I think more and more people are taking social media and podcasts and blogs, YouTube, all that kind of stuff to cover grassroots and non-league football at the moment. Maybe partly that's because none of us can actually go out and play and watch football at the moment. But I think that's really grown in the last year. I think that there's been more and more people interested in the grassroots game. So hopefully that stays when we're all out of this COVID mess. Hopefully we kind of keep up the support and the love for grassroots football.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's exactly it. We started this as just a way to sort of keep the players connected, really, originally. Like you say, you can't physically meet, you can't physically train as a team. So we did just keep it together. Then we got some positive feedback. So we tried to provide a bit of entertainment. We've had some really good guests on. We've had, Dan Edwards was my coach at QPR. We've had Alex Rhodes, was professional at Brentford. Last week, we had Moses Duckwell on, who plays professionally out in Finland at the moment. But yeah, grassroots is obviously where we're at. We're looking to go into sort of non-league. Eventually, we'll take that step. In terms of the coverage, where did that start for you? Where did the passion come from non-league?
I've always been a fan of non-league football. I grew up in a town called Aylesbury in Buckinghamshire, and that was the only football club was Aylesbury United, really, locally. There wasn't a Premier League club, there wasn't a Football League club in Buckinghamshire, so it just kind of made sense that you'd support your local town and I guess have that local town had a Football League or a Premier League team, and maybe it would have been different. But I followed them and sort of branched out and followed, I guess, more non-league now, a bit more of a groundhopper. And I happened to work in the BBC in local radio as a journalist. And so in the last sort of 3 or 4 years, I've been able to combine the two, really, and find a bit of space on the schedule to let me do a show about non-league football. And it's kind of grown from there, and increasingly looking to try and cover non-league from a journalistic sort of standpoint. But first and foremost, I'm a fan of football. I'm a football fan, and it's the love of the game, really. I don't really want to be talking about COVID rules and protocols and all that sort of side of things, much rather than talking about, actual football and all the kind of great and weird stuff that used to go on the pitch when we actually had games. Non-league is a brilliant place for outrageous goals and stupid mistakes and really weird stuff, going on. Teams that had to play half a season because they haven't got a registered goalkeeper, weird things like that happen all the time in non-league. It's brilliant for stories like that. I really miss being able to cover that as opposed to what's the latest government rules, what's the rules on fans, all that sort of stuff at the moment. But unfortunately, that's where we are, isn't it? And hopefully, we're on the way out of that now, and hopefully in the next few months, things can get back to normal.
yeah, fingers crossed. I think we're all waiting for the same thing, sort of, to go ahead. Obviously, they've announced organized football to return from 29th. So we're hoping to sort of return to a league or cup action. That's the plan anyway. I mentioned it earlier where I said about, in terms of obviously people unanimously going to your page to look at stuff. Are you aware of sort of the extent of how much people do sort of take your word as such? Because I said, we definitely did. It was a case of, like, you know, you'd have the government updates and it's sort of like, okay, you kind of have to wade through it. You break it down into nice sort of small segments that it's easy to read. You know what's going on, it's clear cut. And I said, it sort of became a thing. If Ollie says it, believe it, sort of thing.
Yeah, a little bit. I hope people aren't just kind of taking my say so and going out and doing it. And it's really difficult, actually. It has been for, and not just for me, for anyone to know what they're supposed to be doing, because you've got your league and what your league is saying to you. You've got your local county FA, you've got the FA, you've got the government, you've got your local council. There's been times where they've all been saying different things. You know, when we went into the kind of the tier restrictions and things, you'd have the government that be saying, you know, if you're in tier three, you can't do this, you can do this. You have a local council that say something different. The FA would say something or wouldn't say something. Your county FA would say, oh, it's fine, carry on playing. You know, it's like, I don't know who to listen to at this point. Yeah. Listen to, I guess, whichever one is telling you you can play football. But it's like, and then if, you know, it's like if the police came and said, that's what you're doing, are you supposed to be playing this game of football? It's like, well, whose guidance do you show them? Do you say, well, you know, the local FA are saying we can do this, or the FA is like, it's really confusing. And actually, we saw the police not even knowing what the rules were. You know, we saw there was a point where non-league clubs could have fans in the sort of higher tier of restrictions, according to the FA or the government. But the police had a different interpretation. The rules, they looked at something else and were writing letters to clubs saying, actually, you can't do this. It's like, there's so many different people, and I think everyone is genuinely trying to do their best and try and interpret things and try and keep everyone safe. But you've got like 5 or 6, 7 different authorities all telling you different things. So it's been a bit of a nightmare. So, yeah, I hope people don't just totally trust me, because I don't know what's going on half the time.
But no, that is exactly it. You have 5 or 6 different people and it's different advice. Like we had the exact same thing. Like you said, the FA says, OK, cool, it's good to go back and resume leagues up to individual leagues. Then the individual league says it's okay. And then there's another bit of a government advice that then says you can't travel between tiers. And it got to the point where we was having to do surveys with the league, and we were having to sort of say whether or not we would be able to field a team based on the players being in one area, because obviously our league covers Essex and London. So you've got some players that are coming from London, some that come from Essex. Like us ourselves, we've got players that travel in from central London, and we've got players that sort of on the outskirts of Essex. And it's turning around and then going, well, actually, you're not allowed to play, but you are allowed to play. And then you can train, but you can't. And if you come and play, it just got crazy. Like, it really did. And the rules didn't make any sense. And trying to wade through the FA and the government guidelines, it was a nightmare. And it tended to be, like I say, it was, have a look at Ollie's page, see what he said. I'm sure he's understood it at some point, and it just sort of broke it down a little bit easier. So genuinely from us, thank you for the coverage. I think it's great for non-league and grassroots football. How do you see it moving forward? Do you think it's just going to be a straightforward return, or do you think it's going to be?
I really hope it will be. And I think it will be, actually. I think, you know, the numbers are going in the right direction. More people that got the jab and that are protected, the less people that can catch it. So I think, look, you know, none of us really predicted that this winter was going to be as bad as it's been, but I think we're heading in the right direction. I think increasingly as well, it's been proved that outdoor sport is really safe. There are very few cases of COVID being transmitted on a football pitch. Now, the challenge around that is lift sharing, it's getting on transport. It's you know, those side of things, the changing rooms, those bits that are, I think, still the challenge, because you can't just sort of click your fingers and teleport onto a football pitch. You know, you have to get there, and unfortunately there's going to be coaches, minibuses, cars and things like that. That's part of it. But I think we're heading in the right direction now. I think everyone is quietly optimistic that next season will be hopefully pretty normal, and pretty normal for the players and fans as well, because even when we have had football back, I don't know how much you guys have known, you know, there's so many rules, so many things you can't do, and you can't shake hands before a match and all that side of things, and fans aren't allowed to, you know, in certain numbers in certain ways, and And for volunteers that have got to work out, you know, what they do with changing rooms and all the COVID protocols and health and safety, you know, it's not fun. There's been a point where, it, you know, people involved in football, it's not what it used to be. And we need to get back to that before people lose interest and just get fed up with this sort of stop start, you know, huge amount of rules they've got to follow. We need to get back to what it used to be like a year or so ago. Otherwise, people are just going to fall out of love with the game, I think.
Yeah, I think that's bang on. We've had it, like you say, not being able to use change rooms. It's been a huge one, especially when the winter was so bad.
Oh,
you kind of, gosh. Yeah, like...
Especially when it's raining as well. Oh, my God.
Do you remember that last game we had at Castle Green when it was raining and we all had to go under that and it was...
I went in my car, mate. That's ridiculous. Then they have a word of that.
Man hasn't been able to shoot foot in months. Like, every week, man jumps in the motor sweaty and I'm like, I just need to get home.
Yeah, it's not great, is it? I don't know. I wanted them to do something about it because after, especially when it's muddy as well, and then you can't have a shower afterwards, it's like, getting changed before the game is when it's raining.
And it's
like,
cutting and we're getting changed outside and we've got to stand on bench.
Man. Yeah, it's those sort of things, like you say, that you then start to lose a little bit of love for it. I mean, myself, we have two adult teams. So at home games, I'm having to go around and temperature check 32 different players, record score. It's just, it adds on 30 minutes of your time. You don't really want to be doing, going around individual ones, writing down. It's just, it gets a little bit silly. It adds on time that you don't want to be doing. You understand why you need to do it, but like you say, it really does start to take its toll when you go, do you know what? It's not the same. We're not back to how we were. I want to get back to that sort of thing. But Ams, I know you said you asked me earlier, didn't you, about how COVID's going to affect football going forward. I don't know if you wanted to say it to...
Yeah, no, so, Ollie, nice to meet you. It's a pleasure to have you on the show. As it's been well documented throughout COVID, and it's always seems to be, we're talking about Prem teams in top leagues in France, Italy, Spain, and how they've been crippled financially. And when it's coming to the window, you know, this January transfer window was shocking in terms of money spent, and it's been well documented at the amount, how COVID has really affected football financially. But not much has been covered on a non-league level and in levels where some people don't even know, can't even name you teams, let alone who's playing. Like, how bad is it at a lower league level? Like, how will some teams have to fold? Will there be possibility of teams making some sort of comeback? Like, how bad is it in the lower leagues?
Yeah, it's been really bad. You know, it's clubs that are reliant on fans coming through the gate. You know, we're not talking thousands of fans, but clubs where, you know, they might have 100 supporters, 80 supporters, charging £5 each, and they might buy, you know, a couple of beers in the bar afterwards. That's how these clubs fund themselves. That's how these, you know, pay to join leagues. That's how they pay players' expenses. And they've not had that. You know, we're looking at August before some of those leagues get back. So they'll have had, what, 2 months football maybe this year in 18 months. So, yeah, they've had so little revenue. It's been a nightmare. And we've lost a few. I'm amazed we haven't lost more, to be honest. But, you know, we've lost a few non-league clubs, but we generally do every year. We haven't lost loads more than we'd have expected. And to be honest, got no idea, you know, how. I think it's down to volunteers, it's down to chairmen putting the hand in their own pocket and spending their money to keep them going. So hopefully we don't lose any more. But it's been really, really difficult. And then you look at, you know, grassroots teams and when they used to be able to, I don't know, put on a little minibus or something like that to get to a game, and all the, you know, keeping bars open and things like that, and just being able to, you know, sell it, couple of drinks afterwards, things like that they haven't been able to do. That added on to like the extra cost of even the, you know, the COVID stuff, the sanitizer and the temperature gun, all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. It's been really, really difficult. And there hasn't been a huge amount of support available, really. There's been a couple of grants, but nowhere near the amount of money that we'd have liked from the government, from the FA and from the Premier League. And, you know, you don't want to compare it too much, but if you look at how much money the government has provided for arts, for theatre venues, for things like that. There's been so little of that that's gone to non-league and grassroots football. It's been really difficult. I'm amazed we haven't lost more clubs, to be honest.
Do you reckon, like, bigger teams, and I'm talking, like, basically teams in the Premiership, do you reckon they could have contributed maybe a bit more towards the lower leagues, because we all know as football fans what it's like, you know, and how much money fans actually do bring in on a match day. And like you said, not every team brings in 70, 80,000 fans on a weekly basis. Some, it's a couple hundred. But you reckon more could have been done further up the football ladder?
Yeah, I think they could have done more. I think they could have done a lot more. But having said that, you know, they're in difficulty as well. You know, Arsenal had to lay off 50-odd staff, didn't they, over the summer because, you know, they haven't got the money. They're
Money. They're playing Aubameyang like 300k a week. What do you mean they ain't got the money?
Aubameyang salary can cover a lot of non-league teams.
That's the thing. It's hard. It's hard seeing Premier League clubs do stuff like that, like furlough staff, like, you know, Kate from the kitchens getting furloughed, but you got Ozil's being paid 350 grand.
If you think about it, like, the loss of a non-league team, maybe they're losing a couple thousand. As much as it affects them, but a bigger team losing 20, 30, 40 million, it's a heck of a lot more of a dent like in your pocket than it is for a lower league team to be losing out on a couple grand. So you can understand in one aspect why they've not wanted to help as much, because for them, they're making massive, massive losses.
Yeah, I think they're struggling, aren't they? But yeah, you're totally right. You know, signing Willian for on a 3-year contract for whatever reason, on £300,000 a year, compared to what that could do for non-league. But I don't think they're ever going to, unless they're forced to, they're never going to say, okay, we're not going to sign a player. We'll you know, send it all down to the Northern Premier League. I just think it's unrealistic to expect them to do that. Eventually, the Premier League was forced to find money for League One and League Two to keep that going. I think they gave them 50 million in the end. The government sort of had to force them to do it. They've done bits and pieces. They have provided grants here and there and a bit of money, but not a lot. But they're existing in a different kind of stratosphere of money, aren't they? But they're struggling as well, I think.
Yeah. On a positive note, so taken away from COVID, I mean, is there kind of any teams or any players that you think people to watch out for non-league football as well? Because I mean, you cover way more than I do, and I've got a couple of friends who play non-league football, but just for the show, I mean, is there any kind of teams or players that you think players to watch out for? Because it'd be good to then like put more attention on non-league footballers and players in particular.
Ollie, if you don't mention a good friend of mine and somebody I grew up with, I'm gonna be really upset.
Oh mate, oh, no. Forget about
I low key, because they're not far from me, I see a fair bit of Boreham Wood in the National League. They're one of the teams I cover, and really pleased to see Sorba Thomas get moved to Huddersfield last month. He's a really good young fullback. He can play up front as well. He you know, got a dream move to Huddersfield, to a Championship side a month ago. He's a really good player. And the guy that plays on the other wing for Boreham Wood, Kane Smith, is 21, 22, really good fullback as well. I think he's one to watch for the future.
Cool.
But you've heard it.
What about Mohamed Betamar? I'm sure you know who Mohamed Betamar is.
I don't know who he is.
Oh, no.
Not got town.
You ain't got a clue, mate. You ain't got a clue.
Ollie.
You ain't got a clue who he is.
Who's he play for?
He was at Barnet, but he's at Aldershot Town right at the moment.
I'll keep an eye out.
Keep an eye
out. He's on his radar, mate. He's on his radar.
He basically just turned around and said, sit down and shut up. So I was told, and obviously I've done a little research before you actually came on, that you're also something to do with Football Manager. So I wanted to find out a little bit more about that myself, because obviously I work in an industry where, don't get me wrong, I don't mind my job, but I don't absolutely love it. I mean, that must be a job that you just genuinely think, like, you know what, that's something I actually enjoy. How's that feel? And what is it you're actually doing?
Yeah, it's brilliant. So I don't do loads, but I do a bit of research for some of the non-league teams, basically. I put the stats into the game, you know, so-and-so 6 or 7 for crossing, or what his pace is, and all the kind of career stats and stuff like that. Brilliant. I've always loved the game since playing sort of like Championship Manager in the late 90s there. I just think, I think you're either a Football Manager man or you're a FIFA man, aren't you? And for me, I play a bit of FIFA, but it's all about Football Manager for me. I just think that's so realistic. I think they're brilliant.
You're gonna get an invite to the Maskell household very soon.
It's what I was going to say. I'll, just play,
I'll play one game. 6 hours later, you're researching your physio's history from 10 years ago. Yeah.
My days. You're joking.
No.
It's mad, isn't it? You just lose time to them. But it's because it's so frustrating and so difficult that it's so rewarding, isn't it? It's so hard to win things. When you do, you feel like you genuinely really achieve something. And I think we all fancy ourselves as a bit of football
manager. What's your greatest football manager story though, Ollie? Like, have you taken a non-league team to like Europe?
Yeah, I did years ago when I was at uni, which probably says a lot about how hard it worked. Yeah, I did St Albans City into the Champions League. So five promotions and into the Champions League. I think that was like 15 seasons in the game and about 2 years of my life. But still proud of it. Still name you half that squad. And it was probably 10 years ago and none of them were real players. You know, they were all kind of new gen players that the game had generated. But yeah, I'm very proud of that.
You start to feel feelings towards those players. You get a new gen player and you're like, yeah, him. And you almost convince yourself he's a real player. You get a new gen come through and he starts banging goals in for you. And then, you know, a couple of years later, you're like, oh yeah, what ever happened to him? Forgetting he wasn't a real player.
He's not real.
I've done it so many times.
One of the best things about being a researcher and doing some of that is that they occasionally name a new gen after you. So every now and then in different people's games will be that Ollie Bayliss that'll pop up. Normally a kind of like a one-star ability left back at Scunthorpe that retires at the age of 20, you know, gets released. But yeah, occasionally people will send me like a little screenshot of my player or me in their game as a player. I don't think I've ever won anything anywhere, but yeah, it's quite nice to just sort of pop up in people's games.
Have you played football before?
Sorry, say that again?
So did you play football before you started this?
At youth level I did. I was not very good, which is kind of why I do what I do now, because if I could play football, I'd be playing football and not covering it. But it's sort of the next best thing. I was kind of underwhelming sort of right winger youth football, not at any kind of level, but sort of no pace, couldn't really cross. Worked hard. I've always been like, you know, quite willing and like positionally, because I just, you know, I watch so much football. I feel like I know where I'm supposed to be and what I'm supposed to do on a football pitch. It's the actually doing it bit that I struggle with. But I still play. I play five-a-side every Thursday, or at least did before COVID. I still try and play as much as I can.
George might get a job there. I had to throw one shot in. No more.
Oh, mate. I'm lucky.
Yeah, I mean, if ever you boys need an underwhelming right winger that can, you know, do a job in the last 20 minutes and run around a bit, then, you know, give me a call.
We've got Nana.
Oh, shut up. I'm at fullback, mate. That's why.
I can play on the left.
Okay. Well, left foot.
No. Cut inside.
That's weird. Cut inside and it's banging, top bins. Good to go.
Scuff it wide. But yeah, same idea.
Well, you're absolutely welcome, Dan, to come and watch a game if you sort of get spare time. I mean, like you say, there's nothing better than standing in the rain watching a bit of grassroots football, is there?
No, exactly. I mean, hopefully when it comes back, the weather might have got a bit better. Hopefully, you know, we play a bit in April and May. I mean, to be honest, it's Britain. April's still going to rain, isn't it? But it might be a little bit warmer rain than it was over the winter, at least.
We're actually getting decent seasons now. It's actually like, got a bit of wind, a bit of snow, and now it's...
But the funny thing is, I saw people around my way, they were salting the floor like they were expecting snow again.
Oh, please no. Don't.
Oh, so confused.
I hope to go to normal snow.
We're a club that obviously, you know, we've got a five-year plan. COVID kind of has interrupted that a little bit. But in terms of for us, we're looking to sort of, you know, break into step six and things like that. What advice would you give, one, me as manager, and two, sort of to the players as well, in terms of, you know, we've got players that have played through non-league, including myself, but in terms of taking a club from grassroots to non-league, what would you say are sort of the real key components that you need? Obviously, you see so many different clubs. Is there specific things that each club sort of has that kind of ties in, or what do you think the setup is that we really need to push on with?
I think if you can get a good core of players, it sounds like you have, you know, you can see it's not like going up from League One to the Premier League and, you know, professional football. Actually, if you've got a good core of players who are dedicated and going to work hard, you can really bounce up the leagues. Quite a lot of clubs do that. I think it's the players and having that sort of togetherness and not not kind of ditching those players when you go up a level and try to bring in other players. And I think some clubs get to step six and start trying to throw money at players and bringing them in. And actually, some of the clubs that have done really well in non-league are ones that haven't paid players at all and have just bounced up through the divisions with a good core of players who want to work hard and want to stick at it. And generally, a sign of a struggling non-league team, a grassroots team, is one that gets through 70 different players in a season, that chops and changes and you know, brings players in and other players leave and get fed up. Then you can keep a good core of players together, do really well.
I think that's a great shout. So what you just mentioned as well about players trying to change when they get to a certain level, it's something I've been wanting to discuss on the podcast, and I thought I'd ask yourself quickly. I've seen a lot of stuff on Twitter over the last sort of few weeks when steps 3 to 6 was initially null and voided. There was a lot of players from those steps that were then talking about coming down to step 7 and 8. Where do you stand on that? So as a manager, if you was a manager at the club, would you agree in terms of taking those players? Or would you sort of be like you just said, keep the core players that you've already got? Because it's a difficult one. There's obviously a lot, there's pros and cons to both. A lot of managers would say, well, you know, a championship club wouldn't turn down a Premier League player if they were available for 3 months. But then on the flip side, you've got it where, like you said, you've got a core group of players, you upset them and bench players for the sake of someone coming for a couple of months and then disappearing again. I'm just wondering what your views are on that, because you cover so much non-league.
Yeah, it's definitely happening a lot. There's definitely a lot of players at that level that are looking at trying to join a step 7 club or a club below that to play a bit of football. I think I'd try and stick with the players I've got, because I don't think you're going to win much in this time period. It's going to be about mini cup competitions. It's going to be about sort of half finishing seasons. There may or may not be promotion in grassroots leagues. You can understand why you'd want to bring in a player to get results and if you were looking to get promoted, but I don't think that's on the table for a lot of clubs at the moment. So I think, you know, stick with the players you've got. Stick with the players that are going to be there again next August when you start the season. There's not really any point in bringing in players who would just want to, you know, win a few games for you, because ultimately, where does that get you in the long term? It doesn't. I think a lot of leagues are looking to sort of introduce a rule where if you weren't registered before the lockdown, you can't play for teams now. And I think that's probably the way forward. I think, you know, stick with the players that have got changed in the rain under a marquee for you in October, you know, that are willing to do that. Because they'll be the ones that hopefully will be there in August as well.
That's exactly it, yeah. That's exactly how I feel as well. It was just an interesting debate. I've seen a lot on football Twitter, and there's been a lot of different opinions. So yeah, I just thought it'd be good to ask yourself. Has anyone else got any questions before we let Ollie go? Because so I know he's got to shoot off.
Just promote us, please.
Get us out there.
So unshameless.
Nothing wrong with that, mate. Nothing wrong with that.
Nothing wrong with that at all. Thanks, guys. Really, really appreciate the invite. It sounds like you're doing some really good stuff. I'll try and get down and see a game when we're back playing.
Cheers, Ollie.
Really cheers, mate.
Thank you very much. Nice one. Have a good evening, mate.
You too.
Look after yourselves. Take care.
Thank you, mate.
Right, so we're going to move on to another Would You Rather section now. Obviously, big thank you to Ollie for joining us there and talking through grassroots non-league. Same as we did previously on another podcast, we had some hilarious answers. We'll dive straight in, ask a question. Lads, if you give me your answers and explanations as to why. We'll start off with quite a nice tame one. Would you rather win the FA Cup and be relegated or finish mid-table but no cup?
Well, didn't that happen to Portsmouth?
Yeah. Wigan as well, wouldn't it?
Wigan, innit?
Yeah, as well, yeah.
I don't mind winning the FA Cup and get relegated.
Nah, it's got to be a mid-table for me.
You know what?
If I'm being selfish, I'm going to say FA Cup, because if I win the FA Cup and I'm one of the best players there, I can get moved to a bigger club afterwards. If I'm being purely selfish...
So it's nice to see the loyalty is coming on show, isn't it?
you want a truthful answer, so I'm giving the honest truth. I don't know what to tell you.
With all the European games in a 46 game season in the Championship,
wow,
that is a lot. Plus, yeah, you've got enough. The FA Cup, the Cabarro Cup, depending on how low you are, the FA Trophy.
The what cup?
Was it Cabarro?
No.
Carabao.
Is it Carabao? I don't listen to that energy drink cup.
Wow. We have another dumb comment. We have another dumb
comment. That one, a dumb comment. It is kind of hard.
Who watches the energy drink cup?
It's not hard.
Yeah, that drink there, I don't care. It's poison. That drink made me sick. That drink is horrible.
No, I remember, tell you what.
There goes our sponsor.
Yeah, there goes sponsor.
I don't want them to ever sponsor us. Fuck off, because they are the worst drink ever.
Is it the little cans? Do you remember? Did you ever when I went to school? I used to go into the shop. This is when I was like year seven. Ryan, you'll know. Do you know the shop by Royal Liberty School?
The one near the roundabout, or the one closer? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. They used to sell an energy drink called Pussy, and I used to get it just for fun. It used to taste like shit. And I used to be walking around and be like,
do they still sell it?
I don't know. They still sell it.
Yeah. Well, how much did it cost? Like 29p or something?
It was like 50p. Like 50p for a can of pussy. Spending out £5 every day. Like,
yeah, go on.
Fuck's sake.
I mean, I'm not really how we deviated from that question. At all.
Right. Mr. Simples.
So Nana, you're going FA Cup relegation.
Yeah.
George?
I'm saying mid table. I'd rather save the humiliation of being relegated. There's highs and lows in football, but a relegation is just a long period. Do you know what I mean? It's like you've had to have a pretty poor slog throughout the whole season. I'd prefer to just stay in the league. If I'm honest. Yeah, if it's the Premier League and then you're getting relegated to the Championship, then yeah, stay in the Premier League.
Yeah, I agree.
I agree with George there.
You are with nothing ever in your career, then basically.
That's not the question, though.
No, but then potentially you may not ever win nothing in the Premier in ever. So there's a chance to win something.
But equally, but you might win the Champions League the next 4 years.
It doesn't matter if you're good or not. Harry Kane's one of the best strikers in the league, and he's still not won anything.
Exactly, but therefore, you look at him thinking, oh, he just scored 100 goals for Tottenham, but won nothing.
I'm going to edit that part out because he hates Harry Kane.
Who does?
Chris.
Can we say that on the podcast?
I'm saying
still, he's won nothing. So
he's won for a call.
Right. Yeah, but equally, if he was to move to another team, surely he would win more stuff. So if he was to move, he's banging goals, don't get me wrong, but we've had this conversation before. I don't class Harry Kane as world-class because he's not won no trophy.
Thank you very much, George.
That's what I say.
What do you mean?
I like...
How do you mean he's not world-class? Like, name a striker in the league that's better.
Nana, cool. Hey, Nana, wait. Nana, let me ask you a question.
Chris, this is why I've been saying so long, because you're trying to chat shit right now.
No,
how
Nana.
How do you say Harry Kane's not world-class?
Nana, but Nana, Nana, let's settle something, yeah?
Go on.
If Harry Kane was to retire tomorrow,
yeah,
would he go down as one of the greatest strikers ever?
Yes.
How? What has he done? He's got
Wait. I would say something here. Tottenham are a very, very average team here. He's brought them up to this level, number one. His goal ratios for Tottenham is incredible.
Yeah, but we're not disputing his goals. We're not disputing his finishing ability.
What do you want the man to do? What do you want him to do?
He needs to be selfish and move. He needs to be selfish and move.
No.
He's a loyal guy. You want loyalty?
No. Loyalty don't make you go down as a great...
I'm just watching Chris.
He's great.
No, he's not. He's not.
Do you know what I am? Harry Kane is not attractive on the eye. I can admit that. Yeah? However, in terms of what he brings to the table... He's a clinical finisher.
No, 100%. Yeah, 100%.
So therefore, he's got everything locked up. Left foot, right foot, header. No pace, but he can finish. So what more do you want him to do?
He needs
win
to
a trophy.
Your career can't be defined by golden boots and PFA team of the year.
His job is to do one thing, to score goals.
Okay. Scoring
goals and you don't win shit.
Listen.
Name me a world-class player that hasn't won a trophy other than... If you're saying Harry Kane, name me a world-class player that hasn't won a trophy.
I can't put it on my head right now. It's kind of...
Exactly. Late. You can't.
Alan
Shearer, absolute bowler. He played for Blackburn, won a Premier League.
At Blackburn.
With Chris Sutton up top.
Yeah, I didn't think so.
For me right now, in the world, he's top five, top strikers in the world.
I've just had a look at who's in the running for the golden shoe at the moment. Harry Kane's 10th.
He missed a lot of games. He missed a lot of games, mate.
But he hasn't.
There's players like Andre Silva above him.
He's for 2 months.
Nella, he missed 6 games.
Come on, all right, lads. I've been serious.
Patrick Bamford, a striker that's come from the Championship, who people have said he can't score goals, has scored more goals than him, bro.
I'm telling you for free, any team will take Harry Kane in a heartbeat.
Yes, they would. They would.
He's not world class, though.
He is.
No, he's not.
He's not, Nana.
I'll ask you again. Nana, I'll ask you one more time. Name me a world class striker that hasn't won nothing. Answer that question for me, and then I will leave it.
Me and Chris.
Yeah.
Hey, Ryan, tell him about my finishing today.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Is it finishing or is it just dead keeping? I don't know.
I'm FA Cup anyway.
Come at me when you can touch the crossbar.
That needs to touch the crossbar, mate. You're fatted.
Right, again, I have no idea how we got distracted from
I'm telling you, it's Nana every week.
Yeah. Why are you blaming me for?
Yeah, it is you. It's always you.
What? So why am I fixing this?
Because you're always you just like being controversial.
Hold on. Do you know what? Like, I'm gonna end this question. And I'm gonna say my bit and that's it. Nothing coming back. I can't stand Harry Kane, and I agree with George's point. I can't think of any world class players that haven't won anything. However, I do believe Harry Kane is world class. Based solely on the fact that I believe he would play for any single team in the world. Simple as that. That's it. And that, to me, is how I judge a world-class player. Could he play for Bayern? Yes. Could he play for PSG? Yes. Barca? Yes. Atletico? Yes. Like, it's simple as that. If you can play for all of those big teams, Man City? Yes. United? Yes. If you can get into those teams, then you're a world-class player. It's that simple. That's my bottom line for it. So,
man just spoken. I'm right again.
Gaffer rules.
Gaffer rules.
Fuck off, all of you. Me and Ams are right here. I don't care.
Right. Next question. So, would you rather know how or when you die?
I'd rather know how I die.
When?
And you avoid it if you know that.
Oh, fuck that, bro. Man said when. That means you're going to be living your life on a time scale, waiting for that time to come.
That's better. That's better. So then we can do everything in advance.
No. I don't want to know when I'm going to die. That's long.
But surely you know when
you how you're going to die.
You'll know how you're going to die. So surely you're just trying to avoid it.
If I die like skiing in France, I'm not going to go to France.
But then it's one of those things, isn't it? Like every Final Destination movie ever, if you know how you're going to die and you try avoiding it, you still end up dying that way anyway. Like, if life's planned, if that's your way to go, like, that's it, isn't it?
You know? All right.
At 50, I'm going to do a fuck load of shit. So when I hit 50, I've ticked everything on my bucket list and I'm good to go.
Yeah, I'd rather know when I'm going to die.
I don't know when I'm dying.
Yeah.
It depends. I think it still depends. Like, if I can avoid it, like I said, if I know that I die skiing in France, like fucking 38 years old, I'm just not gonna go to France. In none of this Final Destination shit, like, I'm just not gonna go. Like,
yeah, but
the question was that's when and how. Surely.
Yeah.
Because you're saying when you go to France.
Suppose so.
When you're however, like, that's but when and how you're gonna die. How are you gonna die? So. Okay, I get hit by a car, but you could get hit by a car anywhere.
It's like that, then I'd rather know when. Yeah.
And what you gotta remember as well is that if you then avoid the thing that you die from, it then just changes, surely.
Yeah,
it would then just change, wouldn't it?
Like, if you've Chris avoided been watching that, Final Destination lately.
I'm saying as in, like, if you avoid the thing that you're meant to pass away
bye
from.
Bye, yeah.
Then something else has to replace that. So you then don't know what's going to replace it.
So no, like I agree when then.
Imagine knowing when you like how you're going to die. Like you're going to choke on a grape or something like that. That's fucking nuts, isn't it? But like, imagine like for some dumb.
It's like a really wimpy way out. Like, yeah.
Dumb, like,
how about knowing when to die? You can plan your funeral. like to the tea. You can plan your last dates.
Nana's gonna have like a banquet of wings coming in from Morley's and that, and Bear Grease. He's gonna have a Morley's flag on his gravestone.
He's gonna wear. He's gonna have a bar full of wings, and he's gonna jump in.
I mean, I've been doing wings as well.
You know how they have open casket funerals. Nana's gonna be sat there with a Morley's wing in his hand in his casket.
Ever a wing in their hand, and it's got
and grease. Hey, grease, leftover grease coming down.
Hopefully, it connects his beard.
All right, cool. All right, wait.
Oh shit!
All right, okay, man. So next one. So this is one that my kids decided to ask. They said they wanted to ask this. Would you rather be a superhero or a supervillain?
Hero.
Villain.
Nah, villain.
Villain.
Oh, of course you would, Am.
Trust you would say. Yeah, I was gonna say trust you would say villain.
Villain.
Nah, villain.
Trust this guy, man.
Nah, hero, man.
Captain.
What do you gain from being a villain?
What did he say? I missed it.
Oh, fuck off. Can we wrap the show up there? That's it. Finish with
that. That's the title of the show.
Nip that bit out.
What did he say?
No, staying in.
You'll see next on Saturday.
You see on Saturday.
Ah, that is brilliant, Chris. You're a fucker.
That was good.
All right, so George, what are you going?
Gotta be superhero for me. I'm a massive Marvel and DC fan. I prefer Marvel, not gonna lie, but
yeah.
I'm a massive Marvel fan.
I watched a Punisher recently, George. That was ill.
Yeah, that's good, isn't it? Decent. Oh, decent.
Sick. That was yeah. ill.
Punisher is sick.
Yeah.
What a series.
I like Punisher. Yeah, no, I'd have to be a superhero. It'd have to be that. Because imagine, I'm like, just being a superhero, like when you grow up, you always thought, oh, I want to be Superman, I want to be Batman, I want to be Spider-Man. But my thing was Iron Man. I fucking loved Iron Man. He's such a geezer.
Think about it, as a superhero, you've got so much expectation to do the right thing all the time. And when, like,
bro, you're a superhero, who cares?
No, but think about it. Imagine you're just chilling. You're at home. You're kicking back. You're watching the game. You cracked open a cold one, and you hear someone getting mugged outside. There's an expectation that you've got to get up and deal with it. I'd be like, fuck
nah, that. We leave that shit to Batman, bro.
But as a super villain,
we have powers.
Yeah, but as a villain, surely you're just chilling at home, and then you're expected to go out and mug an old lady. Like,
yeah, but you can do that whenever you feel like it. My point is,
a super villain. We're not talking about a guy that goes and robs handbags. Super villains. We're talking like some crazy shit.
Yeah, are we talking about like the Joker here or Thanos? Like, come on.
Yeah, what sort of level are we?
No, but my point is, as a super villain, you do stuff on your time scale. Like whenever you feel like it. I might be a dickhead today. I might not. Pretty much.
Yeah, but
like,
villains have like this mad plan, like to take over the city and
the world and then they end
up using some potion to do a mad thing to people, and it's nuts. Villains are hard.
Nah, listen. Like, if I was Iron Man, I'm not helping old Doris get her handbag back. Like, I'm fighting things that are fucking coming out of the sky and shit. Like,
yeah,
for me, I'm going to be a villain.
So what we've got, two villains, two heroes.
Yeah.
I'd probably go hero, I guess.
You can't have a Punisher tattoo and go villain.
But Punisher's not a villain.
Hold up. Don't be putting the Punisher under villain category.
No, I said you can't. Like, have a Punisher tattoo like a hero and then say you want a villain.
But he is a hero.
The Punisher is the real hero of them all. Like, he's just on smoke non-stop.
Yeah.
Listen, the
I thought you were calling him a villain then.
No.
You do that to my kids and my missus, I'll do the exact same thing. I'm going for Punisher or someone. So, yeah, I'm going a hero. But I ain't following no Batman rules where you don't hurt anyone. Fuck that shit.
And you gotta wait for them to bring up that Batman sign at night. You gotta be at your window every time. Oh, is it come up yet? I'm going.
Just WhatsApp me instead.
Yeah.
Superman is like really, really strong, and like he's not human. So Ramsey can't have sex then, because if he has sex then he's going to kill every single person who has sex.
Bro, why is this in your head?
Are you saying he's got ectoplasm spunk?
Why does, how that? Did that, what's super?
No, but think about it.
That don't even make sense.
Man's got acid spunk.
You're thinking far too much into this.
No, but yeah. You got to think about
it. You must think he's got some superhuman spunk, like freedom, like he just comes, his spunk just comes out swinging in
freedom.
You know,
what?
You know, you understand I asked this question because my kids asked this, and now I've got to show them this back.
Cheers,
guys. Yeah,
Nana, nice one, mate.
Fuck's sake.
Sorry, I forgot his PG. Sorry.
Once again, Nana's proper fucking.
He keeps going out, thinking outside the box. He thinks too much.
Sex education right now for your kids.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah,
don't go to Nana with sex education, guys.
Don't come to me. No, don't. Trust me. I'm the last person to come to
me. Right. So, mentioning kids there, then another one. So, would you rather that you had made it as a professional footballer or your son?
Everyone's
got kids and all this stuff, but obviously, you know, some of us have got kids.
This ties back into when we had Dan on the show. And he was saying how you get a lot of parents that push their kids because it's like they're trying to make their kids live the dream that the parents couldn't.
Yeah, I agree. Oh. But
it has to be me.
I'm going for me.
Do you know what? Let me just say why. I would say my son, 100%. Because here's my logic. If I made it as a pro, your name's out there, you're already rich, you're already famous, so that kid doesn't have a normal upbringing. Yeah, they're going to have an upbringing where they're used to money, they're used to the standard of everything being here. Like Dan said, you then go one or two ways. Either the kid loves football and wants to be like their dad, but if you're a decent pro, that kid's never going to live up to their dad. So that kid might then end up falling out of love with football.
You look at Haaland.
I wouldn't want to do that to my kid. So for me, I would rather watch my son make it pro, if that's what he wanted to do, and sit there as a proud dad and go, yeah, that's my boy.
Yeah, but you're not going to know that until you've not became a pro. But then to him, wait until...
you're going to have to sit there being broke till like your 20s for your son to start looking up later.
That's my point.
Why do you have to be broke?
You're going to have to... you might as well make your son's life easier and give him a chance to start off. Because when you look at it like this, Chris... You got to still remember, your perspective is spot on, yeah? But when you think of it of your, right, Chris Maskell's made it pro, he's a great player, whatever, he's done the business. Chris Maskell's not made it pro, he's an average fella from South London, North London, wherever, and it's going to be twice as hard for your son to get recognised. So even if he has got talent, How hard is he going to have to work to actually prove it? Whereas if you're already an established name, like we've got, for example, like George said, I think, who said Haaland?
I did.
Yeah, Ryan said Haaland. Right, his dad wasn't great. He was at Leeds. I think he was at Man City as well. We all know him for being broken because of Roy Keane's crunching tackle, you know. But his son has not only exceeded his dad, his son's taken that Haaland surname to a completely different level. And you sold us a graphic the other day of what he's got a cousin who plays for Molde as well, who scored like 60 goals in 20 games and that. So it's kind of like a win-win for both.
I don't know if the question was quite fully understood. What I mean is your kid wants to be a professional footballer but doesn't make it. So I'm saying either you get to make it and your kid doesn't.
Oh, you've changed the question.
No, it's the same. That's the question. Would you rather make it as a professional footballer or your kid made it?
If he wants to be, then my son.
What I'm saying is, you made it as a pro footballer. Your kid then wants to, but because you made it as a pro, he doesn't. Or you don't make it as a pro, but your kid does. So for me, I'm saying my kid. I'd rather my kid has his dreams. Simple as that.
If he wants to be, then I'm going.
That's
my
different
son.
Then.
That's what I'm saying. I think the question might be misunderstood. I'm saying if you make it as a pro, your kid doesn't, and if you don't make it as a pro, your kid does.
Definitely kid then. Definitely kid.
I understand the logic about what you're saying about, as in, if you've made it pro, that kid's got more contacts. He's more likely to be pro. He's grown up in a better environment, better life, not worrying about money and all that sort of stuff. But then equally, like you said, Ams, you've got to wait 20 odd years or whatever till you find out if that kid's going to be a decent pro. Yeah. But just the sheer fact of, if my kid wanted to,
I'd give up anything.
Oh, then yeah, if it's that, then definitely. I'm taking him football every day or whatever he needs to, everything to, yeah, definitely.
If you have a look at, like, Ronaldo, CR7.
I've got dodgy knees anyway.
If you look at how he's doing it with his son, and he's come out and he's blatant, he said, look, like, I want him to become a professional, but I want him to come out and become a professional on his own merit, not because of the name. And if you look at the videos of him now training with his dad, and from, he's already given him the foundation.
Yeah.
So for him to go out there and do his stuff. But you know what? I feel sorry for him because he's got some big boots to fill.
You
mentioned Weah and Haaland and that, but this guy, he's something else.
It's like Messi's son. What's his granddad's like Maradona, and he's
Aguero. And Aguero's his uncle or something.
Yeah, he's a good father. Yeah.
Imagine that, like, three of the best Argentinian players in the last, like, 20, 30 years. Like, you're just not going to live up to that whatsoever.
I think for me, personally, I'm going to still say myself. The reason being is that, take away
from... Selfish.
No, wait.
He's already said he'd leave a relegated club to save himself. And now he's saying, fuck the kids, I'm taking
me. Wait, hear me out for one moment, yeah? Take away the actual football side of things. If you watch a lot of ex-footballers who reflect on their career, a lot of them weren't happy. A lot of them went through a lot of misery and went through a lot of trauma as well. Very few of them, like, I'm talking about a percent of them, actually came out of it, still financially stable, still mentally up there, didn't go through any rehab or something like that. I don't want that for my child. You see where I'm coming from? There's only so much I can do to protect it. In this social media era right now, you have one bad performance, the amount of abuse you're going to get, it's horrible. You see where I'm coming from? And I'd rather take that than have that on my child. So if I really love my child, you want the best for your child. So even though the passion might be there, and yes, it's great, I'm thinking, I can't protect my child from that stuff. It was like 30 years ago, mom should be hunting my child. But now, this day and age, it's hard. And I get it. Because as a parent, I can't sit there and watch my child go through it and come back and then hear that abuse again. Look at Marcus Rashford.
He does that is, unfortunately, with the way that the day and age of football and that, it's just part, it's becoming to the stage where it's like it's becoming part of the game. Like
and that's the more reason why I wouldn't want my child to do that. Because if you have a child of yourself, you need to think about, they want something which they like, but as a parent, you know what's good for them or not. And you know your own child. And if you don't think they have the ability to then deal with that pressure, because I don't think a lot of people can actually deal with actually being a professional footballer. Take away the off-field side of things. And me personally speaking, it'd be hard for me to watch it. Now, of course, you can try and support as many as you want to, but for me, I think it'd be difficult. So I'd rather take the abuse myself and go through it rather than seeing my child go through it. If social media wasn't in play right now, I'd say 100% my son. But you can't control it, because even all of us right now, we're normal living guys and we still go through mental issues one way or not. And it's hard for us. So imagine that 100 times more. You can't even walk out of your house without someone's getting onto you.
It's part of the job and the lifestyle, Nana.
The difference is that how... Are you trying to say that, oh, it's part of the life, so part of the job, so I'm going to sacrifice my mental well-being just to be a mental footballer?
No, it's part of the life now, because football as a culture has done nothing to stamp it out.
You can't, though. It's impossible to stamp it out.
You can't, but something, there should be measures in place that prevent somebody from jumping on a keyboard, on their phone, at home, wherever, sending, tweeting people, directing, messaging them on Insta. There's got to be something that can be done. We can't just sit here and be like, oh, it's happened now.
I agree with you, but it's not even just the social media side of things. Even it's like the normal stuff of, like, going on the street. We now have the ability of free voice now. We can say whatever we want to, and then we're not being charged for it or not being, there's no backlash for it as well. So even just literally walking down the street, someone's onto you about anything that you do, your dress sense. Now, look at Paul Pogba. I know he gets a lot of stick. Sometimes he asks for it, but sometimes it's like, oh, it's a bit too much. Mm. It's a bit too much. You see what I'm coming from?
And you could go the other way, though.
Wait, and therefore, you've got to remember, not just the kids, the grandchildren as well have to go through that same issue as well. And as a parent, you're looking at thinking, I have to watch all of that, and I can't physically do nothing about it. That's a lot.
But so also, on the other hand, if that kid, say, imagine that kid has fixed his sights. I want to be a professional footballer. You've seen it with so many young people dropping out of the game. He gets to that point at what you sign a professional contract, like 17, 18, like that. Imagine he gets turned down because, just say, we was the professional footballer, and he's just completely set his, or her, eyes
and
on that.
And
the disappointment can also have the same effect.
How many players do you see released from academies at 16, 17? I mean, there was the young lad from Man City who unfortunately took his life. Was that the one that died recently?
Yeah.
And you then have that side of it. I think it's one of those things. If you really delve into it, it's kind of an impossible question in terms
of...
There's pros and cons to both. I just think for me, I personally would sacrifice the fame, the money, and the glory for my son getting that, if that's what he wanted. Yeah. But like Ryan said, make sure that I built up enough resilience in him to understand the pressures that come with it. Even just playing non-league, I've had to deal with it. Like I say, I've had my own fans spit at me before. Yeah, I mean, when you do, even at grassroots football now, you get people,
we had incident at the start of the season where certain comments were made. And so this is not just something at the top.
Oh, yeah. That was mad. Yeah,
I remember that. At the top. This is something that stems all the way down to Sunday League.
Yeah, it's true.
So there we go. Another 20 minutes on one question.
Yeah. Linking into this one, then next question. Would you rather go back in time to give advice to your younger self or have your older self come back and give advice to you now?
Oh, no, I'd go back a million. From this age now?
If you could go back from now to your early teens, say.
If I could go back to being 15, I'm going straight back.
Telling myself to bang money on Bitcoin. Listen. It gets to this age, I'm sorted. I'm banging as much money as I can on Bitcoin.
It's about life. Decisions that I made that I've...
That is a life decision.
Hey, Ryan, did you see that prayer that he dashed his hard drive and he had like 12, 15 Bitcoin and he dashed it in a council thing and the council can't help him to get it back? Oh, my days.
It was something like 500K worth of Bitcoin.
For me, it's not about the money. It's about decisions that I've made that I wish I could have learned. Because you know when your parents tell you stuff and then you're like, oh, you don't know what you're talking about. And then you look back and think, maybe I should have listened as well. I think there's a lot of stuff right now that I wish I could have done better or listened to their advice. Whereas anything the older me will tell me right now, I kind of know already now because I've learned from the experience. There's nothing new that...
But if there's stuff that you're struggling with now, the older you would be able to tell you that it gets better or worse and you'd be able to plan accordingly from now, if that makes sense. That's what you got to think about.
If there was one thing
if you've got stuff right now, like you're like, say you're struggling with, you know, the kids or the money or the house or football or this or that, or a job, you want to change jobs, and you're sitting there going, that sort of thing. The older version of you would be able to go, look, take that risk, do it, it works out, or don't take that risk, and this is where you end up, and all those sorts of things. You know what I mean?
But me personally speaking, just because of where I am in my life right now, I'm not saying I've got it all figured out, but I kind of know in terms of what I want to do and kind of how I'm going to move anyway. So even if it's the right or cool or not, I think I'm mature enough to now learn from my mistakes and say, okay, you know what? This is kind of how I'm going to move on. So I don't need somebody... I'm not saying like I don't need wisdom now, but I think back then I could have definitely used it as well. Because not just the financial side, but just life decisions that I've looked at.
If I could go back and listen to anything my parents said over the years and I could change one thing, it would be the circle and the people that I rolled with.
If you went back in time, you'd be able to drive. So
Number two. Wait.
That's twice.
It's calm. I've got one more year to go and I'm back on the road.
Jesus Christ.
Oh. I've done 6 months already.
Now, do you know what?
The car insurance is going to be fucked by the time you come back.
I think with this one, it's another almost impossible question. I think for me, I'd probably go back, but solely for financial reasons. There's a couple of things I would do differently, don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
But I'm very much a kind of everything happens for a reason, sort of thing. Like, if it's going to happen, you can try and change stuff, but then something else is good. I'll go back and I'll change a couple of decisions that I made. Let's use football, for example. Like I said last week, I was offered chances, scholarships in America. I was offered to go and play like football out in Austria and stuff like that. Cool, you go back and you say, oh, I'll take it. Take a risk. Why not do it? But then it then impacts me having my family now. You know what I mean? So the only thing I think I would go back in time and say is, say there's a couple of personal things maybe, but the only thing would be save your money. Like invest so that you and your family later on down the line have got a comfortable life.
Yeah, you know what I mean? So my one of mine is that money, but the second one is look after your knees.
Yes. That's because you're overweight.
Wow. That's because all the driving I can do.
hitting him drive-throughs, isn't he? Drive-throughs.
This man walks up to the drive-through. He's like, "Can I have a burger, please?"
You know, I love that that joke just slapped hands back in the face. He thought he was onto a winner there, didn't he?
No, good, mate.
I'm not gonna lie. I think I would go the other way. I'm different. Yeah, I'm a bit different. I personally don't regret anything that I've done. I live like what? I regret nothing.
Wow.
I regret nothing. Why the fuck you lying? Why you always lying? Oh my God. Stop fucking lying.
A confident man, boy.
The way I look at it is that I was brought up. Listen, hear me out. I would. Unless it's for the financial reasons, if we're taking that out, I wouldn't go back and change stuff because it again, like a bit like what Chris said, you wouldn't be where you are today if you change stuff. I'm very, as much as you get stressed, you're like mentally you're not there all the time and you've got different stuff going on with family members, this, that and the other. But essentially if you was to go forward 10 years or someone like 10 years from now will be able to come to you and say, look, make sure you do this or you can do that. Because I mean, I'll be honest, like my mum's not the most of wellest of people. So if in 10 years time, me was to come back and say, look, make sure you spend more time with your mum or you do this or you do that, then I think I would prefer that because I feel like so far leading up to now, I wouldn't be me if I hadn't have made my mistakes. So that's me.
Yeah.
I wouldn't change a lot. It would just be them two things, the knees and then trying to get set up some money.
Yeah.
Bionic knees. You can go forward 10 years and they'll be able to tell you some robotic knees.
I am actually Iron Man.
Yeah.
There you go. And then you've got a superhero question as well.
Right. Next question then. So would you rather take a Roberto Carlos free kick to the chest or go into a 50-50 with Roy Keane?
50-50 with Roy Keane.
Fuck off. No way. Free kick, gotta be.
Have you seen his cast, Roberto Carlos?
Oh wait. 50-50 that you win or lose.
What is 50-50?
Or just go into the 50-50 with Roy Keane.
I'm just asking you.
Why not?
Because a 50-50 is a 50-50. That's
it. I'd love to stab Roy Keane. I've had
bigger men before.
I ain't taking nothing from Roberto Carlos.
No. Remember, I've seen a man physically run you over and
try. Exactly. And I came out all right afterwards. It took me a minute or two.
It took you 45 minutes.
You were playing golf.
Chris, Roberto Carlos free kicks are dangerous. It can literally kill
you. Wait. How close is Roberto Carlos?
Doesn't matter.
No, it's not accurately
hit. If you're standing like 15 yards with your chest open like that and he gives it full pelt, he's like,
Ams, how far away do you have to be from a free kick?
10 yards.
There's your answer then. fucking idiot.
But that, you never said a free kick.
Why are you going
to... Yes, he did.
He said a free kick.
He didn't. He said to take a free kick. Oh.
Yeah. Oh, you weren't listening, mate. Oh, I've only got 10 years back to start listening, mate.
He's still thinking about his joke, that's why.
Oh, I'm going to rock King. I'm intrigued to see what you'd say, Chris.
I'd go 50-50.
I'm going 50-50.
All exactly, 100%.
Yeah, all day long.
Because there's a 50-50. There's a 50% chance of you not getting hit.
50% chance of ending up like Haaland's dad.
Nah, mate. We can already see your heartbeat, boy. He'll give you a heartbeat.
That's a 50-50. With Roy Keane, if anything,
no. Nana's dead either way.
I'm like, no, Tim, there, get me. With Roy Keane, innit? Roy Keane's like 5'7".
Is he?
Yeah, he ain't that tall.
You're lying.
Check how tall Roy Keane is.
Nana's trying to make himself feel taller.
I'm 5'10".
1.7.
Fuck off, you're taller than me. 10. There is no way you're taller than me.
I'm definitely going for Roy King.
No, you forget. Nana's 5'8" with VAT.
No. I'm definitely
taller than
you. And number two. Roy King's how tall is Roy King, Ryan?
Oh, he's 5'10". He's a little boy to me. I'm going for 50-50.
Yeah, that's my lot. I'm clamping him. Easy.
I thought he was like 6'3", 6'4".
Nah, I'm 5'10".
If Roy Keane gives this podcast a Super Sunday analysis, it is gonna go viral.
I will have he'll probably blame
Roy Keane.
He's gonna blame COVID on Dagenham United's podcast.
Chris done me in a 50-50, but did we say it was Pogba's fault for not coming and watching? There we go.
Graham Souness just losing his shit in the corner, just rocking back.
I think that's an easy one.
Right, so we've got
four
free kicks and one Roy Keane for Nana.
No. I would take
that was four Roy Keanes and one
free kick. Four Roy Keanes and one free kick.
Yeah.
I don't want a free kick. I want a Roy Keane.
I
want a Roy Keane. I'll take Roy Keane 1-1. I'm 50-50.
Sorry, right. So who's taking the free kick then?
No one.
I thought Ams was taking it.
No, I said for Roy Keane.
Roy Keane, I'll take him.
I've seen Ams turn his back in a free kick in a wall anyway, so he ain't taking nothing.
I've seen a guy throw a ball and it slipped through your hand, mate, from a free kick. So let's not talk about free kicks.
Can we put that edit in? Belfry, free kick.
Let's not talk about free kicks, Ryan, because...
Listen. We'll put George's appearances on here.
He's going to be shooting the keyboard time he's back.
There we go.
That's until he tries to dribble out and then a 40-year-old striker lobs him again.
Yeah, but he's a keeper when he's shit at dribbling. You're a centre mid and you're shit at dribbling.
Saw that video.
Please get that clip.
That's got to be in here, please.
I don't care how many goals you scored that game. You got dribbled by a 4-year-old man.
No,
let's just move on to the next fucking question. So
put that clip in. When he gets turned differently.
That man was 52 like 10 years ago. I don't even fucking have it.
He's got one of them fucking OAP bus passes. That's how you know he's
it was so smooth as well, yeah. I was like, oh. And if he tried to get him back, and he didn't get him back.
The best part was you on the sideline there, where you jump and point to the camera going, it's on camera.
Yeah, that was
nice. Ams, you look pretty pissed off, mate.
I've got dinner waiting for me.
Right. Final question. Would you rather miss a penalty or score an own goal in a cup final that you lose 1-0?
Oh.
It's penalty. What the fuck would I do that for?
Yeah, but
the last player in Colombia, a player got killed for that, so...
And oh, then a goal could be someone shooting and it's going off target and then it hits you. So that's not your fault. So technically, I'll take
you lose goal. The cup final, though.
Right. Yeah, but you're losing it anyway.
Listen.
Yeah, either way, you're losing.
Wait. Say the question again, Chris. Say the question again one more time.
Would you rather miss a penalty or score an own goal in a cup final that you lose 1-0?
Oh, so you lose regardless, anyway.
You're losing regardless, but would you rather miss a penalty or score an own goal?
I'd rather score an own goal.
Nah, I miss a penalty.
Own goal. All day.
Own goal. Because you lot must be pussies if you're letting me come out of goal and take a penalty. That's all I'm saying.
Nah. A penalty.
Start with goal kicks first.
Start with getting on the pitch first.
Ooh! And it's on shots today.
Put out the graphic. If Miles filled in the sheet, you'd see my graphics on the screen right now, my minutes now.
Just be quiet, Ams, man. I can't hear you from the sideline. It's fine.
Oh, his missus is getting it when his podcast finishes.
Sorry? Did you just say his missus is going to get it when this podcast is done?
Yeah, as he's gonna be up. You seen the way he talks to her?
Oh, okay. Oh.
Yeah, no, I know what you're trying to say. I know what you're
trying
to say.
I didn't know which way that was going.
No, don't try that.
That's what I was thinking. What the fuck is he saying?
Like, it's all love, man. It's all love, man.
Yeah, there's bad. Right. That's a whole other level of disrespect.
Yeah.
I thought so. That's what I was thinking. Surely
a podcast, and then just going, "I'm having your missus." That's a bit far. Like, yeah.
That's what I was thinking. Surely that's not what you're saying right now. Let's not do that.
I mean, for me personally speaking, with a pen, it's hit and miss. You're not always gonna score a pen.
No, stop it.
Fuck off.
I've seen people miss pens before.
To be fair, you should be scoring a pen.
Why?
You're 12 yards out.
You've got a big massive white goal to aim for, like,
and the goalkeeper
people still miss regardless.
We're not even allowed to step off our line.
I have seen people miss penalties.
So
but in the cup final you lose 1-0.
No, but you know what the thing is, yeah, when it's the on goal, everyone look at you thinking it's your fault regardless.
No, how the own goal happens. We're not doing like no George Ellacobe chipping his own goalkeeper. It could be a shot that was going wide, hits your ankle and goes in.
Let me just say it a proper basic, yeah? If you score an own goal, then you would have been drawing the game. Yes, 0-0, you score an own goal, you lose the game. But you were drawing. If it's 0-0 and you get a pen, you're winning that game. You see my point? So if you get the pen and you score it, you're winning the game. If you score an own goal, you would have been drawing before that. So for me, missing that pen means that you're not only not winning the game, you're then being precluded in that team losing that game.
Yeah.
I don't know. Do you know what?
Worse.
Do you know what? For me, I'm talking from personal experience, yeah? I remember this, year 10, yeah? I scored an own goal and it wasn't my fault, but it hit me and everybody blamed me. I said that I'm never ever playing centre back ever. It was like a one-off game. It was a friendly game, but everybody blamed me. So for me,
I promise you, if we get to a cup final and you take a pen and you miss it, you're never ever playing again.
Oh, you're lying. You love me too much. You let me play again.
You shouldn't be missing pens though. You just shouldn't.
It happens. It happens.
Like, you ain't got 60,000 fans like whistling at you and trying to put you off.
All right, so with the penalty, then you make sure you score your one, then, isn't it? Make sure you score your one, then.
You should dead it off by the time I get a pen. So
I understand that people miss penalties. I get that. But of course, people miss penalties. Yeah,
people score on goals.
My point is that if you score their own goal, I promise you, 6 months later, a year later, people are going to banter you. But it's going to be like, oh, you numpty. Remember when you scored that own goal?
But the thing is, you're going to feel that pain, though.
If you miss a pen, you've had the chance to win the game.
Imagine the pain and the thing that you're going to feel knowing that you could have won a cup, but you missed that penalty.
That's the penalty that would have won you the game.
But here it is here. You do a really good pen and it's like top bins, but the keeper was done a mad save.
No,
that's a save.
Still missed.
Yesterday, on Monday Night Football,
they had Robert Green talking about penalties and all of this malarkey.
I've still
and
got
Robert Green came out and was like, bro, you shouldn't be missing penalties. Like, if you go top corners, you don't miss penalties.
No, it's more bottom corners.
No, but top corners, is he was saying, the way he was saying it, it's even harder for a keeper to actually move across the goal and actually kind of fly up towards them top corners. You can get bottom corner a lot easier than you would be able to get top.
Depends. Yeah, I was going to say, I completely disagree. Ryan's definitely going to disagree.
It depends. I'd try it.
There's so many choices in this podcast here.
I don't care whether the keeper saves it or you hit the crossbar or you miss the target. I don't give a
fuck.
Point is, you've missed it.
I just hope, everybody's watching this right now. Any of them missed the penalty, Chris said that they're out of the team. So if you miss penalty and you put the Zagreb Football Club, remember today, on the 9th of March,
that's the cup final.
Well, we're going to the cup final because we will. And you miss a pen, you're out of the team, innit? Remember this time, innit? Because Chris said it, innit? Not me.
If we get to a cup final and I take a pen and miss, I'm resigning.
He's just manager. Right,
cool, then that's it then. Guys, look at your new manager. No.
Straight from B Wing, look at him.
Straight from B Wing.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
You're genuinely sticking with missing a pen.
I don't think he's giving me a hard time because I'd be emotional, I'd be upset. He'd be like, oh, it's all right, mate, it happens.
I don't care. Ams is emotional, upset. We're still going at him.
No. Right. How many podcasts have we done? How many games have we played since you did that slip against Debden and we still bring it up every single day?
Yeah, but I was going through shit, mate.
I understand that, but that's no one else's problem. They don't care. If you cost them a cup final, you think anyone gives a shit?
Which one is that?
I'm a nice guy.
I think it's worse. The slip is worse. They're missing a pen.
What? How is that even? How are we even comparing that?
It is worse.
How is it friendly?
No. What I'm saying is that how it was a cup final, 80th minute, what, you 0-0, and I slip, and then they score. I mean, that's worse than missing a pen.
No.
You don't think so?
No.
Really?
No.
Bro, that Durag's too tight on your head, bro.
No, listen,
you've been talking waffle, mate.
But Chris, all bad said, you don't think that's worse?
No. You could slip for any reason.
Yeah.
Like, it could be a shit pitch or say, I don't know.
So what if you slip in a pen then as well then? Same thing then, by the way.
John Terry. John Terry, 13 years on, is probably still feeling inside him, bro. Like, a type of way that he can't ever get.
But look at Steven Gerrard.
John Terry was one kick away from winning the Champions League, bro. Okay,
Steven Gerrard, yeah, club legend. He won everything in the world, and he slips and caught it.
The reason people just get on to Gerrard for that is because he literally said, let's not fucking slip, and then went and slipped. So it's the irony.
But he didn't lose. He didn't lose the league. It was them playing like idiots for the next three games.
That Crystal Palace game is what cost them that league.
Big fucking Cristan ball, and it was what 3-0 up.
But let's be honest. If they won that game, they would have won the league that season.
Bro, go. If you can somehow tweet John Terry, get Agbo's agent to chat to him, I don't know, do something. pull some strings. Yeah. Listen, if you could do something and get hold of JT, say to him, bro.
I know.
Cut that bit out. How many bits that are going to be cut out of this?
I know.
Ask John Terry how that 2008 Champions League final makes him feel. Furthermore, forget that. Who do you reckon feels worse, John Terry or Anelka?
I think it genuinely is just as simple as you should be scoring a pen. And if you score that pen, you're probably winning that game.
Mm. But look at England. England fuck up every single time in a tournament. We have good players, though.
Like, what's I going to do?
It happens. It happens.
I beg you, let's just wrap up this thing, because this press do rags, do my nothing.
No, but it makes sense to look. I was going to say that people like Frank Lampard, Paul Scholes, all them England greats, Gascoigne, they're not good players no
tens
more.
Tens of thousands of fans behind them.
I'm talking about in a cup final, if you miss a pen to win the game and then you go and lose 1-0, people are blaming you.
I guarantee you right now, when it's the Euros, England in the final, yeah, people are going to get on to John Stone.
Stop talking about Euros. No one's talking about Euros.
Final, right? It's the final.
We're talking about us.
Dagenham United versus
I'm saying you. Stop talking about England and all this nonsense. I'm saying, Dagenham, we go and get into a cup final. Bearing in mind, we've still got a fucking semi-final to play from last year. I don't know what's happening with that. That's gone quiet. We go and play a cup final. Well, okay, say when the league restarts. It's looking like it's probably going to be cup games. If that restarts and we have a cup tournament and blah, 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 and we get through to the final, I promise you, Nana, if you score an own goal because someone's had a shot and it deflects off you, I'm going to be pissed. I'll be like, oh, fucking hell. But it is what it is.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you have a penalty, if you say, I'm taking a penalty, Gaffer, I've got this, and you miss it and then we go and lose, I'm ripping you. It's your fault.
Yeah.
I don't care. It's your fault.
I'm saying, personally speaking,
just fuck off with your personal speaking.
I don't know how you could argue with that.
I don't know. I just mean it.
Hold up. So you're telling me, Ams, bear in mind, Ams took our last penalty. So we're 0-0, 89th minute, yeah? And Ams misses a penalty to win us that cup final. And then they score on the counter-attack. They lump the ball long or whatever.
Leicester versus Watford, semi-final.
Let me give you an example.
But the point is, the ball should never have got to the defence if you just finished it in the
place. You see this example? You see this example that Chris just mentioned? I think it was 2014 or something. Anthony Knockhart, Leicester, away at Watford. He scores the penalty. They're going to Wembley. Guess what happens? He misses. Almunia saved it. He missed the rebound. Almunia got rid of it. It went down the other end. Troy Deeney. Remember that? What a moment.
I remember that. But the whole point is that you've got to anticipate if someone misses it. You've got to make sure you are there. You've got to.
All right, guys. I just want to say thank you very much for joining us today on our podcast.
Wait. Before we land, Chris, I beg you, yeah? Because it's the same talking topic I had with Henderson and Rice, yeah?
I'll put a poll out.
Put a poll out.
Yes. Facebook, Insta, Twitter, everything.
Everything, yeah? And I guarantee you're going to eat your words. Bear in mind, you owe Jesse Lingard an apology, by the way.
I'm going to do it. Whilst you just mentioned that, not that you're watching, Jay Ling. I apologise.
What does he do?
I bashed him.
No. Look. It's that Jay Ling's thing.
There we go. Yeah. I bashed him.
Chris Ling's.
Signed for West Ham. Since that podcast dropped, he's absolutely smashed it. I've got to eat humble pie. I'm shutting
I wonder up. If he watched the podcast the night before his first game and he was like, you know what I'm going to prove to this bastard.
He was the podcast speaking, who's this fucking Chris talking about? I'm just saying, I'm the real deal.
Someone just at Jesse Lingard to this. Just keep doing it.
I beg you, tell Dan to at Jesse Lingard. Get Dan to at him. I beg you.
That's what it is. He needed a bit of bashing and then he's played a little bit better. So slag him off a little bit and then he plays a bit better. So hopefully, by that logic, that means Amran's going to be fucking amazing when the season restarts.
I won't go that far.
Whoa. He's basically saying
he's going to start you first game back.
I definitely don't remember saying that.
He's going to start you.
But I don't know why this episode is just me getting ripped. Like, I'm
back. I'm just going to be in a cup final. The day the penalty is going to miss. And then watch. It's not going to be him.
To be fair, I'm just got 100% success ratio of penalties at the moment. So
I still like to get him on the pitch.
I've scored two. Taken two. Scored two. So.
Did you not hear that?
I never heard it. What did he say?
Oh, I didn't say nothing, right? It wasn't me.
It was one of these guys, but it wasn't.
It wasn't me. Person. I was laughing the whole time.
It was obviously fucking Jonesy, but what did he say?
I'm not doing that. Personally.
Chest.
Watch it Saturday. Nah, he said he's got 100% ratio. That ain't gonna help him get on the pitch.
Oh. You lost your position to a centre back, so let's not escalate it. You lost your position to a centre back.
He's got a point.
I mean, I lost my position because I went injured.
No,
but,
you lost your position because you couldn't catch a cold.
We move. I'm not even gonna flame Robert because I like Robert. It's fine.
Oh, friends.
All right, well, guys,
we're
thank
friends.
You to our sponsors. Thank you for our listeners. Subscribe. We love you guys, and we'll be back for next week.
And listen, if there's some do-rag companies out there, I beg you make like a customized one for Nana that don't affect his head, like his brain and that.
I'm promising you, yeah. On a serious note, yeah.
Like, comment, and subscribe, yeah.
Now, on a serious note, did you use Morley's grease before you put your do-rag on?
The waves up there, don't worry about that. But the whole point is this, yeah? The waves.
The coming. No waves.
There's no...
I've got bare waves. What are we talking about?
Let the man speak.
Yeah, go on.
Anyway, I personally think, from my perspective, if I'm being personal, if I miss a penalty, I'm going to feel it 100 times more.
Go away, bro.
I'm going to feel it 100 times more than it's going on goal.
I don't care anymore. I genuinely don't even care about your opinion.
We don't care about your personal feelings anymore.
Personally, I don't care.
I
realize whenever Nana says personally, no, he's going to say
it's going to be wrong.
listen, I'll tell you what. I'll put that poll up on Instagram and Facebook. Would you rather miss the pen or score an own goal, cup final, next week's podcast? I'll put the results up here. And then we'll see. And hopefully, Nana, you're wrong. Seriously, thank you very much for watching. Much appreciated. Please like, share, subscribe. Get out there. Let us know what you think. Any questions you want us to ask next week, give us a shout.